put outside, you know, and bread and all the kind of things that I've really got. It's the other end of, see, there's high tech over there with the dome, and this is the other end of high tech, which is the ordinary, down-to-earth living, they call it living traditions, the old histories.
So high tech and old tech.
That high tech and old tech.
No. Hark! I hear a sound.
Oh, yes! Oh, yes! Oh, yes! Ladies and gentlemen, the Commissioner of the Northwest Territorial Pavilion, Mr. George Braden, and his staff welcome Mr. Jack Webster of the Webster Show of BCTV and Mr. Jim Patterson of Expo Corporation to preview our pavilion and see some of our culture and sample some of our northern delicacies. So stated, in this year of our Lord, 1986.
Hooray, hooray. Name again, please.
Rick Palturek, sir.
Can I borrow your voice?
You may, sir.
And your shotgun if I get into trouble later
on.
You
certainly can.
George Braden, Jack Webster.
Pleased to meet you, sir.
You know Jimmy Patterson, of course. Well, this is quite a surprise. Is he going to be here all through Expo?
We've got a pavilion crier. We're going to have him doing his act in front of our pavilion, and we're going to send him around the site to tell people of all the fantastic things he'll see.
I'll make you a deal. I shall double up for him if he goes wrong. George, you're going to show Mr. Patterson and I around the Northwest Territories Pavilion.
Please.
Let's go.
Okay.
Let's go. Now, we're inside the Northwest Territories Pavilion.
Jack, we're on our way into the special effects gallery.
Well, tell me, how close are you to completion? You've got 5 weeks to go. Will it be ready on time? Will it all be complete?
It'll all be complete. We'll be ready to open and operate April 21st. And what we see ahead of us just now is a sampling of a large photo mural and mirrors.
And I notice you have a big heater in here to make the glue stick for the meantime.
That's right. And what we want to do in this area is to just recreate walking through the landscapes of the Northwest Territories from below the tree line to above the tree line.
Well, we can't see them yet, but we'll be back to see them. And, of course, aircraft played a large part in the Northwest Territories.
That's right, Jack. A local model airplane club produced a number of airplanes for us. There's some of the historical...
We know you're going to do very well, but Mr. Patterson said to me, can we hurry up this section so he can have a piece of muskox?
Okay.
New experience.
Now we're in the business and social center of the Northwest Territories Pavilion, and I see, George, that you've got lots of good arts and crafts available.
Arts and crafts from all over the Northwest Territories produced by our native people, the Inuit, the Dene, and the Métis.
Good show. I hope you sell millions. But meanwhile, we have a very important stop to make here for refreshment for Mr. Patterson. Isn't that right? Have a seat, sir. I've set you up for a gambling game.
Okay.
Very special drafts. Make your first move.
All right.
Well...
You can't jump that, Jack.
Oh, yes, I'm short-sighted.
Wait a minute, gentlemen.
Now, what do we have
here? Would you care to try some bannock, muskox skewer, caribou, and artichoke?
Well, I'll have some bannock, which came from Scotland originally anyway. And what's the, James, your choice?
Well, I'll start on this side. I'll take this one over here.
And just help yourself. Okay, you'll take one.
Okay.
You take one.
I'll take this one right here.
Bannock, what's in this?
Muskox.
Muskox.
Caribou.
Caribou.
And Arctic char.
And Arctic char.
That's right.
Cheers. Jimmy's got more money, but I eat more food.
Well, I'll tell you, it's very, very good. I've never had this before. This is excellent.
Right. Well, glad to see you brought your muskox with you.
It's good, too.
You used the phrase endangered species about places that weren't coming through. Has anybody let you down at all in any major way, in the way of exhibits or pavilions?
No, not up to now, but we got three or four pavilions we're very concerned about the rate of which their exhibitry is coming in, and what we call a fit-out. So we have, but we're working hard at it, and so are the participants, but there's two or three we're worried about right now.
Yeah, but mind you, it's still 5 weeks from the time this is on the air. It'll be 5 weeks before they have to fit out the actual pavilions.
But we're monitoring the schedules really close, and but we do have some worries,
Yeah, that's good. So you really have no endangered species as such. Tell me something I want to ask about. What about media recognition when the fair opens? What can you tell me where the world is going to see it, apart from CTV and CBC and BCTV?
Oh, well, we're going to have... This whole thing's going to be broadcast all over the world. And, of course, the big American networks are sending in, you know, like Good Morning America. And, of course, Dan Rather will be here. And all the people you'd expect. But this is going to be covered virtually all over the world.
Well, it shows you the respect and the priority they've given it compared to the smaller state-type fairs in the United States.
Well, there's no comparison. we announced yesterday our 54th foreign participant. We're going to have 66 governments involved in this exposition, like right now. Compared to, say, a New Orleans that had maybe 12 or 13 foreign countries, I mean, there's just no comparison.
No comparison at all.
No comparison.
Special request. One of Canada's most successful businessmen, you know, it just dazzles me how much you own and operate.
And owe the banks.
I think you would more than square out, James.
No, we'll see.
Yeah, because I remember you way back in the early days when you and I were barefoot boys together.
Yeah, but you've done very well, Jack. I don't make as much money as you do.
Don't be silly. Withdraw that remark. I demand an apology. I'm going to issue a libel right forthwith.
Okay.
And I won't quote the figure of $10 million a week that you make.
That's what I owe, Jack.
Okay, well, I'm going to take you to the pavilion in which you were born, of the province.
Okay, good.
Saskatchewan.
Wonderful.
Let's go. And you may bring your muskox with you.
All right.
A teacher of the Jedi.
Hi.
Saskatchewan. Now, you've been up and down that. Tell me what's in it, Jimmy.
Well, the when you go up the elevator, it's going to show the grain handling process as you would see in a grain elevator, and the story of grain in Saskatchewan. And then coming down, you're going to see the story of a potash mine. Like if you're in a potash mine, what it's like. So the two very important industries in Saskatchewan.
But my spies tell me with great authority that being on the edge of the nightlife, that the Saskatchewan people are really what you might call the swinging province.
There is no question that the Saskatchewan people are out here with a fun attitude. We've never had any better support, cooperation, or excitement than we get from the Saskatchewan people. These people have come out here to do a job and are a lot of fun.
Yeah, but why are they in the nightlife area? Did they want that?
Oh, yeah.
Because over here we've got the rides. Over here, what's that over there?
Well, that's Fat Phil's. Now, Fat
Phil's...
Fat Phil's is a concessionaire, and it's going to be a dandy. And he's quite a guy.
And then the ride, and they'll be closed at 9 o'clock.
No. The Saskatchewan thing, you'll be able to sit here till 2 o'clock in the morning. This is part of the nightlife area, and this place is going to be wide open till they'll probably quit serving after 1, and then you'll have to get out by 2.
Well, they've got a show stage there and a restaurant, stage restaurant.
Oh, yeah, there's going to be all kinds of action. Well, and, of course, there's the entrance to the Canadian pavilion, you see.
The hockey stick.
You go to the hockey stick, and then you catch the direct link to the Canadian pavilion.
Did they pick that themselves, or because you're from Saskatchewan, give them a little edge?
No, they earned it, honestly.
No comment. Now, I'm trying to think of something that would make you uncomfortable. Oh, yes. I asked you your worst moment earlier, and you didn't tell me. Your worst moment when you look back was when you said, unless we can solve the labor problems, let's call the whole thing off.
Yeah, that's right. That was the moment of truth, because, see, what I didn't want to see happen is they get this thing like 90% built, all this money in it, and you couldn't finish it. Because, you know, this is unlike any other basic project in construction. We have to open at 10 o'clock May the 2nd, whether we like it or not. And so unless we could get the guarantee that we had continuity of that labor, there was no sense of us risking
the money.
Well,
even with the odd little problem, you've come through with flying colors, more or less.
Oh, yeah, we've been very happy.
But you've been
hounded
and harassed every time you change one of your top guys, or 4 or 5 people turned up the next day as not being. You just seem to have carried off with great panache. One-man rulership by Jimmy.
No, that's not right. There always has to be sort of a sense of direction from time to time.
And then there was a time I got annoyed at you myself when I saw that paper bag business. No brown bag.
Yeah, that was, as a matter of fact, The board of directors didn't even know that that policy existed at the time. That was somebody...
Right, you still don't want people with brown bags.
Well, no, that's not really true. I think I'd rather have them here with brown bags than not here at all.
All right, let's pick another fight. Do you like the way they sold the tickets so that the scalpers are going to have all the... make a fortune? It's really too good in the way of free enterprise for the 4,000-seat theater to which we are now headed.
Well, we've changed the policy on how those seats are going to be distributed and how many they allocate to each person, because it is a difficult one, that one.
It is a difficult one. Jimmy, my spies tell me that you are actually in the business at the moment of operating some very fancy large nightclubs. Will you take me in?
That's right, and this just go right ahead. This is the way we go to them. Three of them. That's right, three.
Okay, Jimmy, what's the name of this nightclub and the first of our quick nightclub
tour?
Well,
this is what's called The Waves. And this is going to be a real fun place with, of course, entertainment going on all the time. And you can see you got a lounge set up here. And this is one of three nightclubs that we got here.
Oh, there are The Waves. There are some of our old friends down there who have been stuffed and mounted.
That's right.
Next one. Quick nightclub tour. It's around to the left here. This really is a big area, isn't
it? Oh, yeah, it is. It is the biggest, this is going to be the biggest nightclub area in the whole of Canada, right here. We go this way.
This way, sorry. Oh, look at the black light. What's this one called?
This is the Flying Club. Oh. And this is, again, this is one of the real hot deals we're going to have around.
Roundel.
Yeah.
The Flying Club. Oh, is that a plane? Certainly not Superman. Next nightclub.
Then you got a cockpit up there of an old DC-3.
We'll see that on the way out, I think, but we've got to do this in rapid-fire time. So we're now out of the Flying Club. We'll stop here and we'll admire briefly the controls from a DC-3, I am reliably informed. And we can continue to nightclub number 3. What's it called, Jimmy?
This is called 86th Street.
This is the big one.
The new one coming. This is the big one, yeah.
The big one. It's immense.
See all of the
upstairs balconies. Well, we'll stand here and admire it just for a second. It says East End Hotel up there in this old place, doesn't it?
Right.
And gorgeous. Have they all been leased out to operators already?
No, we're at the moment Expo is running all three themselves. And at the present time, we decided to keep them, run them ourselves. But if we could put something together that somebody that really knew their onions, I think we'd like to do that.
Okay, we'll see you in either the Wave, the Flying Club, or what's this?
86th Street.
Now back again to our tour with James Patterson of Expo 86. Very impressive nightclubs, I'll tell you. It's like Vancouver in the 60s, only brought up to date, isn't it?
Well, that's right. It is all in one place.
Now, a couple of... first of all, tell me about the Royals. Is everything all sewed up, arranged, and ready for the Royals?
Pretty well. They're still working on the details, but everything's set for the big opening May the 2nd.
If you have any danger facing you now, speaking for a lot of people, is it not great expectations? Two things. Expectations too great, and secondly, the weather.
Well, the weather we don't control, but my worry is that the people aren't disappointed when they come. You know, we've worked for 5 years to put this all together. There's over $1.5 billion invested here, and now we're very hopeful, of course, that the public and the people are really happy with what they see.
Do you think you've got the message across properly in the great market areas of California and the central states, the East Coast and Eastern Canada?
Well, we have. We certainly have in Canada, and we have on the West Coast of the United States. The message is there, and we're getting a lot of action from Europe. And as a matter of interest to you, we now have sold tickets and got the money in the bank from 33 countries around the world, and every state in the United States, every province in Canada and the territories. We have tickets sold in 33 countries right now, and the money's in the bank. So that's a good sign.
Yeah, let me, not being negative at all, but as I go around the place, and I've pretty well been all over it, though it took you a month to do it properly, I don't see anything in the way of rain shelters. Now, we've all got our fingers crossed. What if it really rains? What can a person do there?
Well, we've anticipated that, of course. And Undercover, we can house at any given time 100,000 people. Now, in an exposition like this, you peak at 2 to 3 o'clock in the afternoon. 75% of your total day's attendance is there in the afternoon, but you can put at any given time 100,000 people undercover in this exposition now.
You mean inside?
Inside, right now.
In the pavilion?
In the pavilions and the concessions and these other places.
Oh, where we are right now, which is called the Plaza of...
Plaza of the Nations.
And this is where all the official functions will
be? This is where all the national days will be and all the big official functions will be, basically right here.
Well, I'll tell you one thing, Jimmy Patterson. You certainly earned your money. I think it was $1 a year.
I never got the dollar, but it sounds good.
Congratulations, James Patterson. And we're all pushing for a magnificent summer and a magnificent expo.
Well, thank you, Jack. It's very nice of you to come down here, and we're delighted to have the chance to show you around today.
As long as I can get a guy like you to show me around, I'll go almost anywhere. And I'll be back without Jimmy Patterson after the break. This is very much color, design, themes, and transportation. And there are three theme plazas. And here is Ron Woodall, my old friend, the famous artist. And I got to do this. Why do I jump every time I see you?
Root beer.
Root beer. And Toyota. You're the great
Toyota.
Commercial man. You're an artist in every way.
You jump for Toyota, you do something else for the root beer.
I walk for the root beer.
I remember. Now I remember. Yeah.
Enough of that nonsense. You're the man who's created these three theme dreams. We are now in the Air Plaza. Create it and point to it for me.
Well, first of all, a lot of people have created these three theme dreams, but... I'll tell you about them. At one point, Expo had five theme pavilions, and theme pavilions have limited access. They're inside. Patty Reed was having enormous success selling countries. We knew we'd have about 80 pavilions, so we decided to go outside. This, for instance, is, in a way, a stylized, symbolic airfield.
Great stuff. Well, let's walk through this one, and we'll go to the next theme plaza.
Okay, let's go.
Come on in, Ron. Now we're in the land plaza. We've seen the air plaza. We're still going to see the marine plaza. And this man here is putting screws into the hoofs of this poor... What's it made of?
Oh, fiberglass and cement.
And what do you call this cart?
Costa Rican cart.
A Costa Rican cart. It's beautiful. Now let's get on to Ron and give me the theme dream for the land plaza.
Okay, there's two elements here. This one, where we're standing at the ground plane, is called the International Traffic Jam. And what we're showing here is how each culture, each society has its own way of decorating up, expressing itself through its carts and trucks and wagons and so on.
And there's an old gypsy, a Romany gypsy wagon over there.
There's a Romany gypsy wagon. There's a big bus from Pakistan over there behind you. There's a Hong Kong tram. There's a jeepney from the Philippines over here.
And a hippie wagon from Canada, 1960s, I think.
Hippie wagon from the 60s. This here is one of those three-wheeled Thailand cabs.
Yeah, three-wheeled cabs. And then... reaching us to the sky to escape the traffic jam is, what is that?
Well, that's a sculpture called Transcending the Traffic. And what happens is, you're only beginning to see the beginnings of this here, but when this thing is full, they're all going to swirl into the bottom of this here tower. They swirl up the tower. You see the cars begin to disintegrate. You become parts of cars, then animals, people, small carriages, and finally at the top is a person on foot, the ultimate piece of transportation.
He's also disintegrating by that
He's
time.
Disintegrating
I'm sure.
too, yeah.
Is there a name to that sculptor or to the sculptor?
The sculptor is Bill Lishman from Ontario. He did that there and then assembled it here.
Well, one thing I must do before I go, I must put my foot inside a Hong Kong tram.
Okay.
Because it looks like a relic from the UK of the 1930s.
Yep. Every one of these are different. I was in Hong Kong last year. I guess you've been there, but...
Yes, I have.
These things are delightful.
But I'm going to signify the end of this little segment by ringing the bell.
Okay.
Watch this. There must be a bell somewhere. Well, there it is. No, I'm changing. Here it is. No bell in the Hong Kong tram. I'm stuck. I'm lost. I'm trapped in a Hong Kong tram. See you later. Highway 86, Highway 86. It won't open. Why won't it open, John? John DeVito.
This is a piece of sculpture. You don't open doors on a piece of sculpture. This is to climb it. This is to make you climb over. See, now you climb. Can you climb over this?
I certainly cannot.
Go ahead. You can climb
over.
No,
I can't climb over.
Hold this. You climb over. You get in there. Come on. That's it. Hey, that's better. Get out of the driver's side.
No, I'm not getting the driver's seat. Who's that shouting at me? Are you coming around here?
Yeah, come right here. Come in from the driver's seat.
You can't get in there.
Sure, you can get in. Now, isn't that great? Have you ever seen it?
Oh, you look so great in there.
I'm in a concrete Cadillac.
This is a not. It's not. This is a real Cadillac.
What year is it?
This is 1959.
Well, it used to be worth about $150. What's it worth now?
It's probably worth at least $20,000 now.
This is a $4.5 million Highway 86 project, and you're the man who designed it?
I didn't design it. There's a group in New York. I'm part of a group in New York that designed it. Yes. Site projects in New York.
Well, it's certainly impressive, but what do we do with it after the fair?
Well, hopefully it would be nice if we could stay here as a public piece of sculpture.
For kids to play on.
Yeah, right.
Well, with my creative friend, Ron Woodall, we're now at the Marine Plaza. Now, even I can see that that's a magnificent symbolic structure. It seems to me like of steamships and sailships.
Yeah, I guess it's our tall ship. Those are just construction components.
But in a couple of months' time, what will be in here, all these beautiful new wharves and floats?
Just the International Harbor.
Right. What's going to happen there?
Well, we've got people collecting boats from around the world. There's going to be some incredible things here. Felucca from Egypt and beautiful Fuchao junk. A big dhow, a 70-footer coming from Pakistan. And all there's 30, 35, maybe 40 of these boats that you've heard of, gondola from Venice, one of those old canal barges from Birmingham in England, and they're all going to be here. You can get on them. You can look inside, see the holes. They're the ships you've seen in the movies, but never actually been near.
Let's go and have a look at this very special place put up by whom.
This was built by Rivto.
Rivto.
Yeah, for Expo.
This is for children of all ages or just tiny ones?
No, they can all go in here. I think a children ages like ours, maybe.
Yeah.
What are you, 42 and I'm 28?
Yeah, 79, 28, yeah.
And in here, you get to pull on the various knobs and buttons, and when this thing is activated, you'll be able to blow horns and
I want to come and blow
the radar work, and there's lots of gauges and all
the steering control.
All the things you've ever wanted to turn and pull.
Give me time and I'll wreck the joint before the kids get to it. Well, Ron, this will be a delight for children, for buzzards and foghorns and whatnot.
Yeah.
And I want to thank you very much for your cooperation and your information.
Okay.
And I'll be back in a very special pavilion after the break. Expo 86 could not have been complete without old 374, which is being refurbished and done up, and here we are in the one truly kind of historic, original part of the transportation. The old CPR roundhouse, right, Ron?
Yeah, that's the only original building, the only 100-year-old building that we have on site. And I think fittingly, we're using it as our retrospective, our salute to the old days, the age of steam, inventors, ingenuity, when people tried and failed a lot and did crazy things.
Look back in history. Mind you, when we go into the roundhouse, we won't see the old roundhouse that the CPR had.
No,
no way.
No, hey. No, there's a few changes in there.
Let's go and see it.
Well,
Hey, this is a surprise. A giant, massive wheel. I presume it's a model of the classic Canadian railroad wheel.
It's a railroad wheel. I guess it is. It's Canadian.
Not made of metal, is it?
It's wood. It was made in a factory in a place called Celikovice in Czechoslovakia.
Celikovice in Czechoslovakia.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think it's pretty fantastic craftsmanship.
You had a worldwide contest to find the best, design for the rehabilitation of the old roundhouse.
Well, for the exhibits in here, we looked at 33 different design houses, narrowed it down to 4, and these people really showed us their...
What else is going to be in this room?
This room?
This was originally the diesel shop, was it?
This was the diesel shop.
It's 1911.
About then?
Uh-huh.
You have also an airplane that's going to fly over here with a live pilot.
Live pilot, a real human being.
An animation troupe that's coming over. We have these in the roundhouse next door. There are more of them.
We'll see that.
Crazy kind of gizmo machines that fly around. We will have these beautiful telescopes over here. Handmade brass jobs that you can look up at little movies in holes.
And the public will be able to swarm around this wheel, will it?
Well, this is just a big... symbolic sculpture. Ask George.
George?
Yes.
Let me get your name right, George. George.
I'm George Czerny, C-E-R-N-Y.
Nice to meet you, George.
Thank you.
And you're in charge of the... What's the name of your company?
Yes, our company is Art Centrum from Prague. In
Art Centrum.
Art Centrum from
Art
Prague.
Centrum.
From
Prague. Are you up to time, up to schedule on all your work here?
Yes, of course. We are up to time schedule for this work, and we must finish till... 4th of April.
The 4th of April?
Yes, of course.
Now, are you going to come with me when we look at the other stuff in the place?
Yes, you can.
And you've got your own Czech crew here?
Yes, of course.
All good Czechs?
All Czechs.
Local joke. No bad Czechs, just good Czechs.
Only
come
good
on,
Czechs.
Ron, we'll take George with us. Well, now, come on. Come on, George. Come on, Ron. Now, what was this originally, gentlemen? What was this building originally?
This is the roundhouse.
Part of the roundhouse, too.
Yeah.
What is this, George?
It's a giant machine. It's a true giant machine with moving pistons and with steam from this piston and noise. And in this space, in it, is movie cinema.
A movie cinema. All these things will move?
Yes, of course.
And this is all wooden, is it not?
Oh, but it's from wood, but with special parts and attenuator. And this attenuator make moving this piston over there.
We shall watch it with awe. Now, Ron, I want you to tell me, we're in the back of the roundhouse now. What's going on here? It looks quite mysterious and fascinating.
It's a long area. We call it the corridor of the anonymous inventors. And you have these wonderful sculptures.
Uh-huh.
And they are, each of them, holding a beautiful model of the little invention they've made. There's one of them set up right here, and it's... It's typical of the kind of thing we have in here, which is ingenious invention. This is a photographer's bicycle. And it's...
I see his penny farthing arrangement. Is that a penny farthing arrangement of a kind?
Well, it's a modified penny farthing, and there's his wooden tripod.
And his camera.
His beautiful old box camera.
And his boss standing over there.
Yeah, and this room, like the rest of the roundhouse, will be just... packed with all kinds of activity. We're going to have 5 or 6 archival movies going on here and a long, long string of this kind of thing. And it's another nice corner.
It is. It's quite huge, too, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
And are these things brought in from Czechoslovakia or are they local companies?
There's both, but most of it was made and brought in from Czechoslovakia, yeah.
What the devil is this here?
This is a, it's an underwater walking suit.
An early diver suit.
An early diver suit.
Okay, Ron, we'll move on from here and see what else we can find out from the creative director of Expo. Well, Ron, this is going to be one of the best pavilions in the whole of Expo. One of the most exciting ones, is it not?
Yeah, these guys have really gone an extra mile.
Yeah.
Yeah, they really
have. And you told me that in there is one of the first Bugattis ever made.
Yeah, we've collected some wonderful, as we call them, artifacts in there. And some beautiful, it's a beautiful racing car from Bohemia, 1899. That's a lovely machine.
Well, it's just incredible. Have you scoured the world yourself for all this stuff, Guru?
No. We've had a lot of people looking for them.
Everywhere.
Yeah.
Why the Guru on your helmet? Why do they call you a Guru? Except for the obvious reasons that you're a bit of the wise man of creativity, you've got a big beard, you're a man of dignity and stature, and you're a famous painter.
Well, it's mostly I deal in intangibles, you know? Is it red? Is it blue? Is it big, small? Do we pick this one or that one? And that takes a guru, I guess.
Won't be long now, though, before you're subject to the searching gaze of the art and color critics of the whole world.
Right.
My thanks to Ron Woodall, the guru, creative director, Expo. There is no doubt about it. This is the world's biggest hockey stick and hockey puck. But it does have a reason to be here. It's the marker to direct you from Expo main site to Canada Pavilion. And while you're watching my colleague Clive Jackson on the scream machine, I'm going to catch the ALRT shuffle from the hockey stick to Canada Pavilion, and I'll see you after the break.
You'll find as soon as we get off the top of the crown that we're going to have a very slow start. You'll almost feel sedate for about a second or two.
And then?
Then you'll enjoy the thrill of the ride. We're on the crown now. That was the spot where we're very slow. Now you're going to enjoy the full throw of the whole ride. The first element we're going to go into is the upside down 360 degrees. Then we're going through the loop now. Very good, smooth. We're now going through the sidewinder where we're going through the side. Very fast, very good and smooth. We're going to come across. We're going to slow down slightly here, and then we're going to be going.
How fast were you going there?
Oh, about 55 miles an hour. Now we're going to go upside down two or three times. Are you ready for it, Clive?
Yeah.
There's the first one. Very smooth and nice. Again, very smooth. Now we're coming around in through down near the station. Now, that was a real fast, smooth ride. Exhilarating.
Worthy Owen. It was very smooth. You want to hang on for dear life for a while, though?
Some may.
Disneyland.
Took the special Expo ALRT shuffle down here to the waterfront station, and I'm going, as ordered, to the Grand Pavilion. I came here specifically to have a look at Canada's most incredible maple leaf flag. That's a flag which had to be slipped through the management committee because, in fact, the flag is made of glittering sequins. And whoever heard of a maple leaf made of glittering sequins? But it's a tour de force, a touch of genius. Now let's go and meet the people in Canada Pavilion. Well, I was pointed in the direction of this place, which is the pre-show for the Canada Harbour Pavilion, by that hockey stick. Hockey stick, hockey stick. Biggest hockey stick ever made. Gentlemen, am I in the right place?
You sure are, Jack.
What's your name?
Brad Nielsen.
What are you doing, Brad? Do you know what you're doing?
Not a heck of a lot, no.
Are you going to be finished? Everything will be ready all in time.
I sure hope so.
Where are you from, Brad?
Surrey.
Surrey?
You betcha.
You look quite bright for a guy from Surrey. Where does your buddy come from?
Delta.
Your name?
Bob Geishek.
Make sure you connect these up right, will you?
Oh, sure will.
Bob, here's my reception committee. Why? As I live and breathe. What? Bruce Howe.
Jack Webster.
You're apart from everything else, you're the Commissioner for the Canada Pavilion.
Commissioner General.
Commissioner General.
Have you done any work around here?
Nope, but Norm, he has.
Norm, we've met before. I admire your giant hockey stick.
Thank you.
Was that your idea?
That was my idea.
I think I'd have preferred the big cardboard Mounties. Was that not your alternate idea?
No. We have 6'2" steel Mounties.
You got them too now?
Yeah, they're going to be pointing to the Canada Pavilion.
Full dress?
Well, they're painted red, and they've got Canada on them.
That's great. Now, I am now in the pre-show, and I want you to show me, tell me all about this pre-show. Well, before I get into the Canada Pavilion, I must come through here.
That's right. That's right. This was a show to kind of warm up the audience. The Goose and Beaver are two actors. There's a male beaver and a female goose, and they're both in very extravagant, very beautiful costumes, and they have dialogue going on.
We must get some more of this detail, because when you told me the last time, I didn't really believe you. Let's go over where the goose and the beaver will perform, and perhaps we might put on our own little stage show. Well, let's go up and start it up here. Now, I'm not going to ask you any mundane questions like how much did this beautiful little place cost, because this is just the anteroom, isn't it?
This is the pre-show. This is to entertain the visitors before they go into kind of celebration.
Did you or did you not tell me there's going to be a 7-foot beaver here?
No, I told you there'll be a 7-foot goose here.
What will the beaver look like, Doc?
Beaver is a little guy like this. He's about 5 feet.
What does the goose look like, Bruce?
He looks like that, 7 feet tall.
But is this a kind of stand-up comedy act?
Yeah, the goose and the beaver have a dialogue which is about the fact that they were here before any of us were here, and they
hey, watch it for the Indian land claims, you'll be in political trouble.
30,000 years, about the same as the Indians.
Oh, about 30,000 years.
Yes,
because all existing rights for gooses and beavers must be protected too. How long will the show last here?
This is, well, the audience could be in here about 20 minutes, but most of them will be in here about 12 minutes.
How many does this hold on a pre-show?
1,000 people.
1,000 people?
600 people every 12 minutes move into the next celebration.
And now you've got real live people who send us, as you're going to send me, into the next, the pavilion proper. Is that correct?
Real live people plus a whole tracery of lights, that the lights come on and indicate it's time to move.
Oh, now, are you only going to play the beaver part, the goose part on opening day, Bruce?
Oh, no, all during the fair, Jack.
May I call you from here on in, Commissioner General Bruce the Goose?
Well, you have called me a lot of other names, and that one's just as good as any.
I want to see the fellow from the Stratford Festival. Is he hiding? Raise your right hand. And solemnly say after me, I will hold this ladder steadily while old Webster is climbing up.
I will hold this ladder steadily while old Webster is going up.
Fair enough. Give me your name, too, in case I have to sue you.
Kevin Clark.
Kevin Clark.
I may not hold it while you're coming down.
Oh, I see. That's all right. And Mr. Howard, too, a good day's work for you today.
Trip,
Liability insurance is all paid up. I signed the release. I'm looking for a man called Robin Craven.
Well, Robin is backstage right now. He's wearing up some sound. What will I do?
You'll do. What do you do here? Are you a creative person or just a worker?
Well, actually, I'm a little of both, Jack. I'm actually one of the beavers as well as a workman fitting up the show as well.
You play the part of a beaver?
I do.
You're not short enough, though you are ugly enough.
Standing on top of a scaffold.
You're one of the creative crew putting this special set together.
Yes, that's true.
Robin did the Shaw Festival sets, didn't he?
Yeah, Raw was quite instrumental in Shaw Festival for many years. Now he's got his own production company called Singular Productions, which is producing this.
Well, thank you very much indeed. All the best.
Okie doke.
See, I can so do come down a ladder. Now, Bruce, how much did this whole thing cost, the Canada Pavilion?
$85 million of your money and mine.
$85 million?
That's right. And you know something else, Jack?
What?
You're going to get full value out of it, and so is British Columbia in Canada.
Oh, I'm sure of that. It's just such an incredible amount of money. Now, we're going to pick up Norman again, and we're going to head towards the pavilion proper.
Head outside.
Head outside. Thank you very much. Good. Thanks, boys.
Okay.
Well, here I am with Norman Stevens and Bruce Howe walking down the Western Concourse. Huge walk. What have we passed to do with the Canada Pavilion?
Three theaters. Canada Celebration, which is the patriotic... glowing tribute to Canada and being Canadian. The next theater is Earth's Watch, which is a sort of aerial survey mostly of Canada, but beautifully done. And then we go into New Frontiers, which is takes us into deep below the water and into space.
All created to cover all the various aspects of everything, said he, getting lost in culture.
Yeah, Nua, getting lost in the stars.
Is there going to be anything different about this for the average Canadian attitude?
Yes, this is going to be...
What is the difference going to be?
Two things. We're going to have a lot of fun at it.
A lot of fun.
And we're not going to be very modest about telling Canadians how good we are.
We're going to be loudmouthed, boastful, and happy.
No, no, we're going to be immodest and having fun.
We're now headed into...
Into the Great Hall, which is on two levels.
Two levels.
That's right.
Great Hall. Okay, and we'll bring you news from the Great Hall as it stands now in the middle of March. Come on, gentlemen, please. You must keep up with me. After the break.
The actual MSAT looks as cardboardy as that, the real thing. But this is going up in 1990, and this is going to be the mobile satellite which will enable you to talk via satellite from your car to a boat or from a train to a truck. Mobile units can talk to each other.
You can't get away from the telephone, Jack.
Even if you're away scuba diving, you'll right. never be able to get away from the phone in the office.
That's underwater. Right. That's right.
Doctor. Or underwater.
Sure.
That's terrific. Now, walk me around.
Okay. This is ahead of us is a giant mobile sculpture, which is based on the Astrolabe, and it has the four rings of space, of atmosphere, the earth, and underwater.
Okay.
Which is the theme of the pavilion.
This is the atmosphere, air, and underwater. How's your atmosphere today?
Fine, thank you.
What's your name?
James.
Come on over. Guys with beards are often more talkative than guys without beards. Tell me, what are you doing here?
We're putting together some of the displays.
Which display?
This one right behind you.
What is it?
What is it? Here's the designer. What is it?
What's your name, sir?
It's Bruce.
Nice to meet you, Bruce.
I'm from Toronto.
Good. You're very welcome.
It's really difficult to say what this is. We call it the Astrolabe because it's rings within rings that all turn around, basically, with some artwork on it. The artwork isn't in place yet.
But you're coming along fine. I could recognize what's up there, can't you? What is that? It's a train with a horse in the front of it. That's what's right. that, Norman?
Those are two of the perpetual motion machines. One is the horse-drawn locomotive, and the other is Captain Vancouver arriving. When they're going, the wheels of the train go around, and the bell rings. And when this one goes, Captain Vancouver is picking up and putting down his telescope, and the paddles are going.
And they're permanent exhibits which will cause great joy and hilarity among old and young.
That's a Vancouver artist, Stephen Denslow.
Let's lean over the fence here and tell me what I see in front of me.
You see a 1907 Haida war canoe, which is the largest war canoe made out of one log that was ever produced, I think, in the Pacific. And it belongs to the Museum of Man, and we have it on loan through Expo.
That's probably the only one of its kind in the entire world.
No, there's one other which is slightly larger, unfortunately, in New York, but it's also a Haida.
Let's get it back. What right have they got to have it in New York?
I'd like to have it back.
Oh, Haida canoe.
That's right.
Well, that's great. Well, we'll go look at something else now. Okay, we're still in the upper level of the Grand Pavilion.
Yes.
And I see the ugliest looking boat I've ever seen in my life. Explain it to me, Norman, please.
That's the Universal boat. And there is, this is called the Alchemy of Invention. The fan goes and blows on the ladder, and from the grass you go up the ladder and go through flames, which we all go through in our life, and then it turns to gold. And above that is Halley's Comet.
Gold at the end of the Halley Comet rainbow. Let's continue, please. We'll see some other little gimmicks here. Don't forget, we're doing this, as I said, in the middle of March, but we wanted to give you a full progress report before I go off there for the summer. Now, Heath Robinson has been here.
That's right. That's in the same genre, as you might say. These are Alex Wise from Ottawa.
Oh, do forgive me, Alex.
And these are perpetual motion machines, and not in motion. They just have to be plugged in. And these are based on folklore, weather vanes, folk art.
I'll give you a little thing you can do in your next spiel. In the Victoria colonists for 1898,
yeah.
when steam power was just in its for the big battleships, yeah. people in Victoria by the hundreds saw flying saucers over the harbor in Victoria. Just looked like that. They weren't muscled by steam power. The imagination takes over the latest development.
Were they colorful like that?
No, just a big, huge liner flying in the sky. And this, of course, here is a plane.
Eh? And a bicycle. And a whirligig.
It's a whirligig, a bicycle, a plane, and a fish.
Yeah. It's all those things, all the elements are thrown in.
Is that Mr. Wise, too?
That's Mr. Wise, too, yeah.
Tell him he reminds me of Heath Robinson.
I will.
Will you? That'd cost $1 if you wanted to buy it, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
How much did you pay for it?
I think those commissions were $30,000 for the two of them.
Take another shot.
$30,000. For two. $15,000 each.
Yeah.
Cheap at that price.
They're cheap at the price. I'm all for Expo. Could you call this way, gentlemen? Could you call this way? What are you doing?
Oh, we tried that up at this one.
Say that again.
Oh, you've been speaking English.
Oh. I'm just fastening onto this A-frame right here.
A quacky oodle.
I guess that's what it's called.
Are you a quacky oodle?
No.
No, you're not. You're a carpenter.
Yeah.
Have you had fun at the Canada Pavilion here?
Oh, yeah.
How long will you be working? Another month or so?
Sorry to say.
Okay, get it up, because I don't like coming under here and seeing it. Let's get it up from the top. Where's Norman?
This
is the beak.
Yeah, but it's...
But
it's going to be like this. Not like that.
And stick and wheel will be sticking.
Over here in this large area here, and the beak will open on cue, motorized, and it'll reveal the quackyoodle history of the birth of mankind, and it'll close again.
Done by quackyoodles?
Done by Bo Dick from Alert Bay.
Alert Bay, quackyoodle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That'll be a priceless piece when it's over.
Yeah.
Is it a new one or an old one?
It's brand new.
Brand new.
Yeah.
Done by?
Bo Dick.
Bo Dick. Right now. Norman and Bruce, where are we now?
We're in the foyer of the theater district. And on your left is the ramp that takes you up to the CN IMAX theater called Transitions. Over there, where those sparkly lights are, that's the entrance to the studio theater, where there will be about 6,000 performances during Expo, a live entertainment. And on your right is the Teleglobe Theater, the Taming of the Demons, which will run throughout the fair.
Teleglobe, is that
sponsored by Teleglobe.
It's on film.
It's on 9 screens. It's Emil Raddock, the guy who was the master at Expo 67.
Oh, the Taming of the Demons.
The Taming
on 9 screens.
Yes.
On 6,000 live shows in the studio theater.
Yes.
And IMAX up here.
That's right. 3D IMAX.
That's one of these frightening things.
Well, it's a huge screen, and it's in 3D, and things come right at you.
Oh, that's frightening. Okay, let's get out here again before the demons catch us. After you, Bruce. Now we're going to the plow. I haven't been here, you know, gentlemen, since a year ago when this was all rather crude and rough-looking. My goodness gracious me. Quelle différence, as we say in Quebec, eh?
Well, Jack, welcome to the crown jewel of Expo 86.
Canada Pavilion.
Canada Pavilion is the crown jewel. It's going to be telling Canadians how good we are. It's going to be telling the rest of the world how good we are. We're going to be having a lot of fun doing it. And, you know, this building is the signature building of Vancouver.
I hate to tell you, I can't even remember the name of the architect.
Zeidler.
He'll go down in history, eh?
That's right. This is the signature building of Canada. Anywhere in the Pacific, when you see this, you know you're in Canada.
All right, hype me some more about the Canada Pavilion. Have you had any disadvantages by the long connection, or do you think, from the hockey stick to the Great Hall here?
Well, we won't know until we open, but we've done everything to make people want to come over here, hockey stick being a sort of a signal, and then we've got that big glitter flag down there.
Well, it's so annoying, that hockey stick, that you're, in my opinion, that you're bound to say, where the hell does that hockey stick? And when will we see the giant Mounties, the silver-covered Mounties?
Oh, they'll be up in a couple of weeks.
But don't forget, Jack, that we have the Canada Gate here, and people will come to Expo by coming to the Canada Pavilion first.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to have a lot of people to tell just how good
How many people can you handle in that hall at any given time, and on all these exhibits at any given time?
Well, we can work to a capacity of 14,000, but 10,000 is more comfortable.
You'll be happy with 10,000, plus one goose and one beaver.
That's right.
My thanks to these eminent gentlemen. Norman Hay, proper title?
Creative Director.
Bruce Howe.
Commissaire General du Canada, Pavillon du Canada.
Merci, monsieur. Après le break. Well, I'm at the western end of the Expo site now in my Expo walkabout, and I am in the
on the veranda of the United States Pavilion. Good representation from the states, California, Washington, Oregon, and of course the U.S. government itself. And I think this is going to be dedicated to space. But we'll go inside and we'll find out what's happening. The U.S. Pavilion, with its $8 million worth of super sophisticated exhibits, is still, of course, in the preparatory stage. And this is Dale Morrison, who's the Deputy Commissioner General for the United States government. Now, are you up to schedule, Dale?
Oh, yeah. We haven't fallen behind so far. Well, maybe a day or two.
And all your stuff is coming in and you'll be open on time.
Oh, definitely, definitely.
Now, tell me, give me the theme of this pavilion.
Our pavilion is on the manned space program, and especially on future developments, on the permanent manned space station that we hope to have up. But, of course, it's been a big program, and it's gone on for many years, so we felt we had to look back at where it's been as well as where it's going.
That's right. It was a dreadful tragedy, that business. Will you make recognition of the tragedy in the shuttle?
Oh, yes. I think we have to acknowledge it and the brave people who lost their lives in it.
Right. So will it be all new technology or will it be some of the old technology, too?
Oh, we're going to show the some of the historic things, the Geminis and the Mercuries, the Apollos, and we're going to look at the shuttle, too. Because we think the shuttle is the key to the future in space, at least in the near term. So in this area where we're walking through now, we're going to have, and I give the people an idea of what a trip in the space shuttle in a couple of years is going to be like, as the preparations that go into it.
And will you be using models, or will you be using some of the original old kind of actual stuff that astronauts use?
Well, this is very big stuff, and we couldn't get it in the pavilion, I'm afraid, if we didn't use models, so we're going to depend on that.
Well, that's good, and all this is supplied by the U.S. space industry through the government,
we've gotten a lot of good advice from them.
Well, now, we've just come through the theater there where you're going to be showing a 6-minute film on the new space station of the future.
Right.
Will the space station be in this area here?
Yeah, right. We're going to have, in the film, the trip getting up to the space station, and off in that corner, we'll have a very large-scale model of what we think it'll look like. It's not going to go up for 8 or 9 years still, but we've got a pretty good idea of what it'll look like.
Matter of fact, I see the place is full of crates, all marked a delicate-scale model, U.S. Marines.
Right. Well, we'll give a plug to the United Scale Models of Houston, Texas. They made them for us.
And very good. Now, may I have this one to take home to my grandson?
He'd love it. He'd love it, Jack.
What is it?
That's the Voyager spacecraft model.
So, are you working on the pavilion here, or are you just delivering the stuff?
We're just setting up the American displays.
Didn't get your name.
My name is Don Spence.
From?
Local 1928 Delta.
Local 1928 Delta of which?
Delta BC.
No, but 1928.
Carpenters and joiners.
Well, Dale Morrison, Deputy Commissioner General of the U.S., everything's gone smoothly, no problems.
Oh, it has indeed.
Are the Expo people easy to work with?
Oh, they're a joy. They are a true joy.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, sir.
We'll see you when you're all finished and tizzied up with all the exhibits in.
Looking forward to it, Jack.
Lots of lies. Hey, do me a favor. Cut it. How can I get my work done if you're drowning out my entire operation with that noisy little generator? Tell me, what's your name?
Mark Snails.
And are you the guy with the high-pressure hose that also splashed me early on?
Did we do that?
You certainly
did. No way.
Good.
Give us a break.
Tell me, how much are you making an hour in this job?
Oh, about $25 an hour.
What?
$25.
What, is this union or is it your own business?
No, it's my own business.
Well, exactly what is your own business?
Well, we do high-pressure cleaning on all types of surfaces.
So you're going to be working from now till the 1st of May, going around cleaning up all these ramps and buildings and
whatnot? Well, if you get paid $25 an hour, I sure hope so.
Tell me, when did you start this business?
May, it was my third year, this May.
How you doing? Many employees?
This is my partner right here.
Hello, partner. What's your name, partner?
I'm Eric Nelson.
Eric, you're both from Delta, did you say?
No, I'm from California.
You're from California. Where are you from?
Burnaby.
You're from Burnaby?
Yeah.
And so you're both making your fortune out of Expo?
Yeah, trying.
Good. Mark?
Smells.
We work best under pressure.
You bet.
Good for you, boy. Now you can start up your noisy machine because I've actually finished my work on it.
Okay.
Thanks very much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Patrick Reed is the Commissioner General of Expo. He's a federal appointment and he carries the rank and status and height of an ambassador, correct?
Thank you, Jack, for all those kind words.
Mr. Ambassador, how many times have you traveled around the world and how many countries have you been in since you took on this job to be the Commissioner General?
Oh, I don't know exactly, but dozens of times in terms of circumnavigation. And, upwards of 100 countries, I guess.
Upwards of 100. And spent some time, I understand, having a ball on cruise ships.
Oh, we worked very hard, actually. We were in, week before last, we were in Hong Kong and in Bangkok and in Singapore. And we got more media coverage than you've seen in Vancouver out of each one of them.
That was on the Rotterdam.
On the Rotterdam.
Which is doing what?
It's the flagship of Expo 86, and it's going around the world, and it's calling in all the ports and all the participating countries. And when somebody like I myself am not there, the captain of the Rotterdam is doing the spiel on behalf of Expo 86.
Tell me, you're a modest man, I know, but have you succeeded beyond your wildest expectations in gathering and keeping the nations together and making them come to Expo 86?
I think all of us actually have succeeded beyond what were our initial expectations, indeed. The thing is turning out very well.
One wee nag. I didn't notice one of the major European nations, Sweden, here.
Oh, really?
Yes, what happened?
Well, Sweden was a major disappointment to me. I spent a lot of time and energy on it. And it's one of the cases where it requires a combination of government and industry to make the decision jointly.
And the government okayed it?
The government actually put money on the table, and we ran out of time as far as industry was concerned. The site is full. We have no more room.
And, of course, you have now finished all your trials and tribulations and can relax except for ceremonial.
What I've been doing up to now has been relatively easy compared to what's coming down the track, because we got VIPs, national days 3 times a week.
And people who think they're VIPs.
And, yeah, Jack, yes.
Yeah. You're the diplomat, let me say.
Well, you said it, and I agree with you.
Congratulations, Patrick. Okay, Patrick Reed, Commissioner General, Mr. Ambassador of Expo 86.
You're a VIP.
Thank you.
Okay.
Jack will be right back after this break.
Rick, and I'm the British Commissioner General, Expo 86.
Which is now being finished up, but you're going to take me into a very special place.
We're in the last throes of it. Come in, Jack, and I'll show you a bit of old King's Lynn, Norfolk, the birthplace of Captain George Vancouver.
That fine old British gentleman.
Oh, he was a fine old British gentleman. Not as some people think, from another part of the continent of Europe. In you go, and
thank
let me
you.
Show you
into
around.
The marketplace. Now, if you could just tell me, Commissioner General... Funny title, isn't it, Commissioner?
Come on, Ted, Jack, come on.
Ted, old boy. All right. Tell me you're going to be the hypothetical bartender for the day.
Yeah, and I'm looking forward to pouring you a nice pint of warm English beer in this old tavern of ours. I should tell you, Jack, that one of our real problems here is that the rest of the pavilion is dedicated to the great modern British transportation story. But we had so many requests from people in BC who said you've got to have a tavern. But here it is, and we've combined this with the fact that this is real King's Lynn, because the designers for this bit of the pavilion went over to King's Lynn, they measured the buildings, and they've recreated the old market square, part of the old market square.
So we're now standing looking at the good copies. They're not just cheap veneer copies.
Oh, they're good copies. They're good copies. And in fact, some of this is reality. The lampposts, the telephone boxes, the tiling, all of this originally came from King's Lynn. And we're also going to have a huge model here of the old house in which King's Lynn was actually, which Captain Vancouver was actually born.
Yep. Are you going to have a free lunch like we used to have in the good old days when you and I were boys?
Well, why don't we do that? Come and try it.
Yeah, right? Gherkins and pickles and whatnot.
Nothing but the best.
And a malt whiskey bar over there.
And 40 varieties.
40 varieties.
40 varieties. A lot of the malt whiskies have never been tasted before in Canada.
Under that magnificent English accented veneer, do I detect a Scottish accent?
I thought you'd never ask me, Jack. A bit further north than to the east?
Slightly more respectable, perhaps.
Oh, no, I don't know about the respect.
Let's go and see some of the transportation.
That's right. I think you'll enjoy this, because we've got a lot of really good stuff in here.
Well, the pavilion isn't finished yet, but you're proceeding apace.
Oh, we're doing very well. There's no doubt that we'll be finished in plenty of time. And as you see, we're moving our heavy exhibits in here. We've already got some very splendid things. Before we look at one in particular, I'd like you to meet somebody here, John Marshall, who's the director of the pavilion, who has the job of being on duty all through these 5.5 months. Going to meet a lot of good British Columbian and Canadian people.
John, as a matter of little background information, comes from that pub sign which is next door, the Elephant and Castle, don't you, John?
That's right, yes, I come from the Elephant and Castle in London.
Well, we'll share a pint there sometime, but I want to know what's underneath this massive orange thing.
Okay. John, let's have a look.
One.
And in here you'll see the fastest car in the world. This is the record-breaking thrust car. It's come, as you see, straight from its record-breaking runs. And it's typical of an exhibition, of course. You can see things on television, or you can read about them. Only in an exhibition like this can you actually touch, experience these things.
So the spot where my hand is now lying at one time was traveling at 600 and some miles an hour on the ground?
Oh, it certainly was. Take your hand away quick.
In a desert. Now, what are the other practical things we shall see?
Well, you know, Britain has a tremendous heritage of transport technology. Radar, the steam engine, and all sorts of things. But, you know, we've concentrated here on what's new from Britain, and we have something to sell the world. Now, over in the corner over there, we've got a high-speed train. Now, lots of countries have developed high-speed railways. But, you know, the special thing about the British is that even now you can go to London and in 4.5 hours you can travel in this train to Edinburgh. Now, what we've done is develop suspension so that instead of spending millions of pounds on special track, that train runs on existing track. And just think what that means to lots of parts of the world.
Save a lot of money. And, of course, you have one very big VIP, Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, coming here on July the 12th, isn't it?
July the 12th. I'm delighted she's coming. In fact, I'm very pleased she's coming for a reason. Ever since I came to Canada, people have been ringing me up and saying, she is coming, isn't she? And so it was a great relief when we could announce it, Jack.
Is she making any major speeches or merely coming as a VIP tourist?
She will be... Oh, no, she's coming. This is her first visit to the splendid part of Canada. And she'll be meeting, of course, Premier Bennett and, of course, Prime Minister Mulroney. That's right. So it won't be just as a tourist. They'll be exchanging views about all sorts of things.
Well, I'll be in the crowd and give it a wee wave.
Do that.
Thank you very much, Ted Allen, Commissioner General, Busy Trevilian.
Come and see us.
Yes, yes. It'll be easy to find the Russian pavilion, which is the biggest pavilion on the site, when you come to Expo 86, because up there, 40 feet tall, will be a statue of Yuri Gagarin, the first man in space, April 12th, 1961. Now, they haven't fleshed out the inside yet, but we're going to go and meet the men who are running it, and they're going to tell us what you're going to see in the Russian pavilion at Expo. Well, I'm on the second floor of the Russian pavilion, and here is...
Yeah, I'm Michael Smirnoff, yeah. Michael, I'm very pleased to meet you.
Pleased to meet you, Michael. And you're a USSR Chamber of Commerce guy in Canada putting together the pavilion.
Yeah, I'm trying to do my best.
Well, now, are you going to be finished on time?
Yeah, I hope so. I certainly hope so.
Let's watch our step here. We'll go over to the edge, and you can give me some idea of the kind of thing that we're going to see. Because, obviously, with Yuri outside...
Watch your steps.
You said it. It's going to be space.
Yes, the major part of our exposition will be about space and our space achievements, space technology. Yeah, that's right.
Space program.
Space program.
And now you're going to have something very special sticking half in and half out, are you not?
Yeah, that's where our space complex is going to be. It will be partly inside the pavilion and partly outside.
Will that be a shuttle as such? It's divided into three parts, is it not?
Yeah, that's correct. It's a space station itself and rocket booster and a small spaceship.
Good. And the public walks around a long walkway there, and there'll be other space exhibits. All space or some commercial?
Well, not really commercial. We'll have, in this part of the pavilion, we are going to have a number of space exhibits. And the rest will be some exhibits on... transportation, ground and sea and air transportation.
Looking forward to it, Michael.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
For your
customers
and cooperation. We're getting near the end of the program now, and I see a character over here.
I know you.
Just a minute, please.
I know you. You're Phil Donahue, aren't you? Huh?
What's your name?
My name is Slim.
I know you, too.
Oh, hello. You do?
You're the head of security at Expo.
Oh, now, don't tell everybody. They'll all know.
Slim, you're a strolling player, are you?
Oh, you betcha.
You look a wee bit like Jimmy Patterson, too, as a matter of fact.
Well, just a little bit, you know.
Now, I've got to go meet somebody over here.
Right. Oh, you're going to see Linda Auglove?
Yes, I'm going to see Linda Auglove.
All right. She's the director of entertainment publicity.
Linda.
Hi, Jack. Good
thanks very
you.
Much.
You're welcome.
If you'll just go away now. No, I don't know. I don't really.
Hey, get away from that gate. Excuse me.
Now, one thing I've got to clear up quickly.
Okay.
I know you've sold all your tickets for the big shows, many of them. Might be some left yet. But what about these 14,000
Free performances.
Free performances.
That's it.
Does that mean strolling players wandering around with guitars and banjos and doing little acts?
It means that, Jack, but it also means performances in folk life, which is the area you've been through, have you?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Had a tour. It also means Xerox International Theater, which is where we are right now,
mm-hmm.
where all the international groups from Senegal, Ivory Coast, all over the world will be
Not
here.
Just strolling players. Impress
Not
me
at
with,
all.
Impress me with some of the international groups.
Okay, we've got Morostica from Italy, and they do a giant chess game on horseback, and they'll be in the Kodak Pacific Bowl. And they're bringing 70-odd members from Italy, plus they're recruiting members of the Vancouver Italian community to do this giant chess game.
Uh-huh.
We've got the hottest fusion rock group out of Senegal, a group called Yusur Nadur.
And they're free. Everything here
all
is
that's
free.
All free, yeah. You wander into this theater, you sit down, and it's all free.
And that'll be throughout the entire range of the expo opening.
That's right. That's
and
right.
Everything will be in the Xerox Theater over here.
In the Xerox Theater, all over the site, in folk life, and in other selected venues around the site.
One last question.
Mm-hmm.
Can I scalp you a couple of tickets for Cosby? I'll let you have them for $100 each.
You got it.
Thanks very much, Linda. Much obliged. Okay. Walking around 5 weeks before the opening, I can tell you it's going to be an absolutely smashing success, Expo 86. Matter of fact, I'm outside the BCTV pavilion just now. And don't forget to visit it when you come to the fair after May the 2nd. News broadcasts start from here April 21st. And I'll see you during the summer and in the fall. Jimmy's got more money, but I eat more food. I'm stuck, I'm lost. I'm trapped in a Hong Kong tram. See you later. And you've got your own Czech crew here?
Yes, of course.
All good Czechs?
All Czechs.
Local joke. No bad Czechs, just good Czechs.
Only
Come
good
on,
Czechs.
Ron. What will the beaver look like, Doc?
Beaver's a little guy. Little guy like this. And he's about 5 feet.
What does the goose look like, Bruce?
He looks like that. 7 feet tall.
30.
30.
30. 30. 30.
30.
30. For two. 15,000 each.
Yeah.
Cheap at that price.
They're cheap at the price. I'm all for Expo.
BCTV signs on.